A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. I'd like to welcome you to another episode of the Beacon of Truth. You're joining us here at the premises of Masjid Al-Mahdi here in Bradford. We're joined by the studio audience, which is from the Khudam here in the Bradford Jama'at, and our esteemed panel of guests. We have with us today Ata'un Nasir Sahib, Ayaz Mahmood Khan Sahib, and Shahzad Ahmed Sahib. And also I'd like to welcome our dear viewers at home. Now, in previous program, we talked about the aspect and the need of Khilafat. Now, in a day and age where the governmental systems around the world have saturated the different countries with various different types of governments. We have autocracies, democracies, bureaucracies. So in this day and age, when the country's governmental systems are so saturated with so many different types, to such an extent where you can almost choose the type of government that you wish to live in merely by traveling to a different country, what is the need, therefore, of a Khilafat, that type of governmental body, a Khilafat in this day and age, as it were? So, Shahzad Sahib, could you shed some light on this?
Well, Masood, there is no doubt that Khilafat is a vital institution for the world in general, but in particularly for the Muslim Ummah today. And its need today is just as essential as it was 1400 years ago, yes. Or in fact, after any prophethood for that matter. Now, in the Holy Quran, we find that when mankind moves away from righteousness and falls into a spiritual decline, then Allah the Almighty, out of His sheer grace and mercy, He sends down His prophets. And the Holy Quran states regarding the purpose of the advent as, وَيَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ. That is that He recites them the signs of God, He teaches them the book, He teaches them the wisdom, and He purifies them. Similarly, when these prophets of Allah come, with them come many blessings and signs and miracles of Allah the Almighty. Now, having said that, these prophets of Allah are also humans, and so they too, after a short period of time, leave this mortal world. Now, if we was to assume that this particular period and the tasks that they have been assigned are only confined to that particular era, then this defeats the whole purpose of the advent of a prophet. Yes. In fact, it has been an established practice of Allah the Almighty that He shows two manifestations. Firstly, He sends His prophets. And then His second manifestation is that He establishes the institution of Khilafat. And under the divine guidance of the Khulafa, those tasks that were assigned to the prophet, they are continue to be accomplished, and those blessings and those signs are also continued. So that spiritual period continues. Now, also the Holy Prophet ﷺ, regarding the two manifestations, has also shed light upon this, and he states that مَا كَانَتْ نَبُوَّةٌ قَتُّ إِلَّا تَبِعَتُ خِلَافَ, that after every prophethood there follows Khilafat. Now, another point is worth mentioning here with regards to the need of a Khalifa, is that the current state that the Muslims there are in itself justifies the need for a Khalifa. We find that the Muslims today are divided into almost 73 sects, and they are indulged into, you know, fighting and quarreling amongst each other. And this is because there is a lack of unity. There's no common ground of understanding. There's no leadership. And since the abolishment of the Khilafat in the early part of the 19th century in Turkey, since then many scholars of Islam, past and present, have expressed their concern that there needs to be a leader, i.e. Khilafat.
Yes, definitely.
Now, although they understand the concept of Khilafat and its need, but however, their process of electing a Khalifa is theologically flawed. The reason being is because Khilafat that we are talking about is Khilafat ala minhaji nabuwa.
Yes.
And therefore it is dependent upon accepting the Prophet, i.e. the Imam and the Messiah of this age, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of Qadian alayhi salatu wasalam. And until they do not do so, their efforts will continue to go into vain.
Yes, definitely. I think one question that actually comes up a lot though is the fact that, as we were discussing, in a day and age where there's so many different types of democracies, autocracies, bureaucracies, different types of government, in that day and age then, how does a Khilafat fit into that? I mean, the question basically which is being asked is, can a political system and a Khilafat system, can they coexist simultaneously?
Yes, of course. As I just said before, that the ultimate, the tasks that are given to a prophet and then which are continued on by the Khulafa were that obviously that it's all spiritual. He is a spiritual leader. He's not a political leader. He therefore does need no political party, neither does he need a state in order to function. And Hazur has many times, President Hazur, and in fact all the Khulafa have stated that in their sermons, that they don't have a political motive, but their motive or their main focus is for the spiritual reformation of the Muslim Ummah.
Okay, thank you. Jazakallah. Now, we've just discussed about how the present state of the Muslim people itself is screaming out for the need of unity. The dissension within the Muslim people now, this lack of unity, the way that the Muslim Ummah is literally scattered across the earth in countless numbers of sects. I mean, 72 was a figure that was a while back. Now, God knows how many sects there are. So now in this time, when we have such a huge variety of Muslims, the state of the Muslims itself is screaming out, whether or not their mouths, even though from their mouths and their writings, they also accept the fact that they need a Khilafat, but their hearts and their states themselves are screaming out for this need. So that in sense is the true need of Khilafat. So now, obviously the question that arises here is that when this was such a beautiful gift and a blessing by Allah Ta'ala the Almighty, is a sheer manifestation of His grace that He gave us, as the Quran also prophesizes and promises that we will give you the Khilafat, we will give the believing people Khilafat. And as a manifestation of that grace, Allah Ta'ala indeed did send Khilafat. So the question arises that why was this perpetual grace, this thing that was supposed to seem to the end of time, this amazing manifestation of Allah's grace, why was it that this ended? At the end of the Khulafa-e-Rashideen, why did this Khilafat end? Atana Sisab.
Jazakallah, Mansoor Sahib. In simple words, the reason why Khilafat-e-Rashida ended was that the same God who prophesied the establishment of Khilafat, the same God informed the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that this Khilafat is going to end after a certain period. It is stated in Mishkatul Masabi that the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that the Khilafat to be established immediately after me shall continue for 30 years. And we see that more or less the period of Khilafat-e-Rashida, the four divinely guided Khulafa, was around 30 years. Then another hadith in Mishkatul Masabi again, taken from Musnad Ahmad bin Hanbal, that the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that the prophethood shall remain among you as long as Allah wills. Then He will cause it to end. Yes. And Khilafat in the precepts of prophethood will begin, and as long as Allah wills, it will remain among you. And then Allah Ta'ala will cause it to end. So again, in this you can understand that a prophecy is being made that this Khilafat-e-Rashida that has begun after the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that was supposed to end at a certain period of time, and that was what happened after the fourth Khalifa.
So in fact, when people send this allegation saying that, well look, your so-called Khilafat, which was so amazing, which was such a beautiful manifestation from God, well then God took it away. So it wasn't really that much of a manifestation. In fact, the beautiful answer to this was that this was actually a divine prophecy beforehand. That this was actually told that, in fact, this is actually, it's beautiful how on one side it can stand as an allegation, which completely fails. On the other side, it stands as a truth, it stands as a proof of the truthfulness of the claim of the Holy Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Because this as a prophecy saying that the Khilafat will indeed end, and this is exactly what happened. So, I mean, after the Khulafa had passed away, and as you said, the Khilafat-e-Rashida, it ended, then what course did the Ummah of the Musliman actually take? What course did the Islamic nation, as it were, carry on after that? I mean, obviously after the demise of the perfect guidance by Allah, when that goes, what happened to the Ummah of the Muslims?
Mansoor, in the same hadith that I narrated earlier on, later on, it's a very beautiful and detailed prophecy of the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that in the latter parts, the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that after the end of Khilafat ala min haji nabuwa, that Khilafat in the precepts of prophethood, kinghood, oppressive kinghood will begin, and it will remain among you as long as Allah Ta'ala wills, and then He will cause it to end. And then tyrannical monarchies will begin, and they will remain among you as long as Allah Ta'ala wills. And that's what exactly happened after the Khilafat-e-Rashida ended. Mm-hmm. So in brief, I'll explain a few dynasties that emerged on the name of Khilafat, although their leaders were called Khalifas, but they weren't actually the Khilafat, Khulafa Rashidin. Mm. The reason why I'm saying that is that there were many differences that you'll find between those self-proclaimed Khalifas and the Khulafa Rashidin. One of the differences was that, in the time of Khulafa Rashidin, they were elected. But when we look at the dynasties that follow, the leaders, they were appointed by their predecessors. So while before their death, they would appoint somebody that this person is going to be the ruler after me. Then again, we see that during the time of Khilafat-e-Rashida, there was the institution of Shura. Now this institution was dissolved in the latter kingdoms that we see. Then we see that the treasury, which was the property of Islam, that was being used for as a personal property by certain kings. And as far as the dynasties are concerned, the first dynasty that emerged after the Khilafat-e-Rashida was the Umayyads dynasty. And this was founded by Hazrat Amir Muawiyah radiyallahu anhu, who was already a ruler in Damascus. And after the demise of Hazrat Ali radiyallahu anhu, this Khilafat, dynasty emerged, and they took upon the title of Khalifa on themselves. This dynasty stayed there for about 90 years, and then later it was overthrown by another dynasty, which is Abbasids. And these Abbasids, they ruled for about 500 years. It is stated in the books of history that the first 100 years were the peak of this dynasty. Mm-hmm. And later on, we see a decline in this dynasty. And there is a thing to be noted, that while this dynasty was in power, there were two other dynasties that emerged at the same time. And they also called their leaders Khalifas. Mm-hmm. One of them was the Umayyads of Spain. So when the Abbasids of Baghdad, they took upon the rule in the as the Muslim Empire, they ordered the massacre of the Umayyads. One of the Umayyads, he fled from there, and he went to Spain and established a kingdom there. Their leaders were actually called Amirs, but later on, after about 200 years, they took upon the title of Khalifa on themselves.
Yes, definitely.
And then, at the same time, we also see that in Egypt, there was another dynasty that emerged, that they were called the Fatimids. And they also, first in the beginning, they were the kings, but later on, when they saw that they are quite powerful now, they also took upon the title of Khalifa. So at one point in history, there were three people claiming to be that, yes, we are the rulers of Islam, and we are the rightly guided, not actually rightly guided, that we are the right caliphs at the moment. Actually, they were all against each other, fighting between each other. Then when we go back to the end of the Abbasids, they were overthrown by Halaku Khan, who was the grandson of Genghis Khan. And one of the offshoots of Abbasids, they set up another dynasty emerged through them in Egypt, in Cairo. They were called the Mamluks, but it is stated in history that they were not actually very powerful leaders. They were, in a way, they were puppets. So they didn't have any political power as such. And this continued until the Ottomans. The Ottomans, they started from the 13th century, and they later on, when they overthrew the dynasty of Abbasids, of Mamluks, they took upon the title of caliphs in them as well.
Yes.
But this happened in intervals. This did not happen as a continuous form.
Yes.
And later on, according to the prophecies of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that once Allah Ta'ala will cause this tyrannical monarchies to end,
yes,
then again Khilafat will be established in the precepts of prophethood, and by the grace of Allah in 1908, Khilafat in the precepts of prophethood was re-established in Khilafat-e-Ahmadiyya.
I mean, JazakAllah, something that it's important to remember. I mean, now we're listening to a historical event. Now many people, because obviously this program is here to educate our minds, to help us understand and open our minds to the things that are going on around us, so that when somebody asks us what we believe in and why we believe in it, we can straight away say, this is what I believe in and these are the reasons why I believe in it. Now this historical event, obviously now this historical event, unless somebody is sitting there and taking notes of this is how long this caliphate took, this is how long this dynasty lasted for, then obviously you won't remember it. But the fact is, the main point that we're trying to get at here is the fact that all of these different kingdoms, these dynasties, they all at one point claimed Khilafat. But in reality, what we need to look at isn't the name of Khalifa, it's the actions that go around by that Jama'at, by that caliph, that person who claims that I am the Khalifa. We look at his actions to see whether or not he is doing the right things that a Khalifa should do, to see whether his Jama'at, his people, his companions are doing that thing which a Jama'at and the companions of a Khalifa should be doing. So I think this is a very important thing to remember, that fine, there is a list of historical events that so and so people claim the caliphate, but in order to judge whether or not they are right, we need to look at their actions as well. So now we're in a day and age where, as we've discussed in many programs before, and every single person within the Muslim Ummah knows this, we're in an age of absolute darkness. A darkness where there is absolutely no unity anywhere. We look to places, we look, and all you can see is pockets of darknesses in every place. You go to a mosque and people don't know when to do namaz, which imam to lead. I mean, a good example for this is, I was actually in a lecture a few days ago, and coincidentally my lecturer was talking to me about this, and he said that he was relating an event of something that happened in Pakistan, and he said that there was a small committee that got together. It was actually a very big committee, it was an international committee that got together in order to make the head of Pakistan the Khalifa. Now in this committee, they had this long talk of hours and hours and hours of talk saying, okay, Tike, fine, fair enough, we should make so-and-so the Caliph so that all the Muslims come together and become in one unity, and then we will rule the world because then we'll be strong and then we'll be united together. And the talks went on, and they discussed, and they all agreed and said, yes, mashallah, yes, alhamdulillah, we have found the solution, we are now united, we are strong again. And then namaz time came. So all the Muslims left, and they walked towards the mosque area, and when they got there, they didn't know who was going to be the imam. So one man stepped forward and said, I wish I should lead the prayers. And a follower of someone else said, well, no, because my sheikh, he has the most knowledge, and according to hadith, it should be the person that has the most knowledge of the Quran. And then a third Maulvi stepped forward and said, well, no, actually, I should have the most knowledge of the Quran because I have served here for 40 years. And then four, five, six people came together, all starting saying, I should lead the namaz because I am the rightful imam here. After 3 or 4 hours of talking about how Khilafat should be there and established to create unity, when the namaz time comes and 5 or 6 people are saying, I should lead the namaz. Eventually, the funniest part here is, eventually what happened was, in that one mosque, they had 5 jama'ats going on at the same time, each person, and they said, do you know what, to resolve this issue, every person, whoever you want to go and do namaz behind, you can go and do it, let's just finish the namaz and let's adjourn the meeting. So this is the state of what's happening nowadays in terms of unity. If you wish to see unity, then we can invite anyone to look at the example of Jama'at-e-Ahmadiyya, about how from every single person from any country, from any continent, comes behind Khalifa al-Waqt, behind the present day Khalifa, and his example of obedience is such that Hazur says one thing and that is final. Be it from America, from Canada, from Ghana, from the USA, from anywhere. Wherever he's from, he'll come, and his exact obedience is such that when Hazur says it, that's final. This is the unity that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in fact, was talking about, the true aspect of Khilafat ala minhaj an-nubuwwah. So I want to come to the audience now. I mean, we're having a good discussion, but I want to see some of the questions that are coming up in your minds now. So please, do you have any questions? Yes, please.
Wa alaikum salam. We obviously, all of Ahmadis believe in Khilafat.
Yes.
But in this day and age, and I'm going to spin this,
a bit, not trying to play a devil's advocate, but I'm going to just phrase in a way. There's a lot of talk about equal opportunities.
Yes.
Quite a few decades, there have been a lot of women rights, and they claim a lot of women rights. So what would you say, or panel would say, if a woman asks, can I be a Khalifa?
Can a woman be a Khalifa? Okay, brilliant. Ayasa, the question obviously here is saying that, can a woman attain the status of Nabuwat or Khilafat, as it were? You're asking about Khilafat, yes, but Nabuwat and Khilafat are very closely interlinked. So please, Ayasa.
Well, you're right. In today's society, we have a lot of freedom fighters, as you will, for equality and rights. But the fact of the matter is that as far as spiritual rank is concerned, the Holy Quran is very categorical. It has mentioned four spiritual ranks which a believer can attain. And that runs from a believer to a martyr, then to a truthful person, and then to Nabuwat. So these are four spiritual ranks which any person can achieve, and there is no holding back. And the Holy Quran is very very categorical that any man and any woman who works towards spiritual enhancement, he or she shall get that, and he shall have equal opportunities as far as that spiritual rank is concerned. But when we're talking about Khilafat or Nabuwat as an office, as a office which is to perform certain tasks and become a leader of the Muslim community, for that case, we do Islam mentions that a woman cannot take on that office. But this is not a degradation of women. This is, I like to see it as an honor for women, because there are certain, for example, a woman has responsibilities which a man does not have to fulfill. For example, just one example, a woman goes through a period where she has to go through the difficulties of pregnancy. And then she has to take care of the upbringing of that child. If she was entrusted the task of looking out and leading a huge community of people, how would she be able to do that? It would be very difficult for her. So Islam does a favor upon women not to overburden them with those things which becomes difficult for them. This is why, as far as an office is concerned, it has been limited to men.
But having said that, the amount that Islam has actually talked about women's rights, the amount that Islam, the Holy Prophet ﷺ has talked regarding women's rights, and how much the Holy Prophet himself fought for women. If we look at the hadith, how great and how beautiful the way in which the Holy Prophet ﷺ acted with his wives, for example. Anyone can read the hadith. This isn't just an Ahmadi thing, this is a general Islam thing as well. That anyone that's read the hadith, even a little bit, and has read the way in which the Holy Prophet ﷺ was with his family, no one can say at all that this is against women. The amount of honor that he would give his wives, the women in his family, the women in his community. I mean, we look today to Jama'at-e-Ahmadiyya and we see how just as the men have their own Khudam al-Ahmadiyya, Ansarullah, the women on the same side have their lajna, where they have a president for the men, they have a president for the women, where they have a secretary for the men, they have a secretary for the women, in exactly the same way. In terms of the managerial side of things, then this has been given as a provision for women. It has made life easier for them, just as Ayasab has quite rightly said, the fact that when women go through certain periods in time, say for example pregnancy and those also other times relating to that, then it is physically very, very difficult for them to go through and perform these managerial tasks as well as doing the things that they need to do. Similarly, on top of this, the fact is that, as we've discussed, women go through certain stages, certain physical compulsions that they can't actually do certain things. For example, there comes a time in the month for women where they can't touch the Quran, for example. They don't need namaz. So when we have a Nabi, a Prophet, or a Khalifa who's there to lead namaz, who's there to discuss and give darses, give speeches, these kind of things, then obviously Islam has given this beautiful message and teaching for the benefit of women. Because it understands that if a woman can't touch the Quran, for reasons that even she understands, for reasons that they don't do namaz, then to expect certain managerial things from her is too much to ask, literally. And women also, if you ask them, they will also agree with this. So, okay, so do we have any other questions? Yes, please, sir. In the third row.
Yes. Yeah, my question, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. My question is, why have the last four khulafas been from the family of Promised Messiah, alayhi salam?
Okay. So the question here then is that why are the four? Are you talking about the Khulafa?
The last four Khulafa.
Yes.
They have been from the family of promised Messiah.
Okay, brilliant. Okay, so an allegation that often comes up here, in fact, is that when we talk about Khilafat, we say it is a divinely appointed rank. But then why is it, and this is an allegation which is perfectly valid, they say that why is it then that four of the Khulafa come from the actual family of the promised Messiah, alayhi wasalam, himself? Shahzad Sahib, could you shed some light on this, please?
Well, first of all, this allegation that is from the family of the promised Messiah, yes, it's answered from the election of the very first Khalifa of the Jama'at, Hazrat Mawlana Hakim Mawlvi Nuruddin Sahib, who was not from the family of the immediate family from the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam. Similarly, we find that even in the Khulafa-e-Rashida, you find that they were also the Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq, Hazrat, yes, Umar, Hazrat Usman, they were also related to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as well. So in terms of that, it's not necessary that they have to be family members, and only then can they be elected. Neither is that in the constitution of the election of the Khulafa. Never does it say that they have to be from the family of the promised Messiah, yes, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's based on prayers and receiving guidance from Allah the Almighty and from His help and divine inspiration that we then vote, and it's up to Allah who He decides is best for that role.
Definitely. Dajjal, do you have anything to add on this?
Yeah, I think I read in one of the books of the of Hazrat Khalifa al-Masih Sani, Zatala Anhu, he mentioned that a time may come that the caliphs might not even be from the Pakistani community. They might be from the Arabs. They might be from the African community. So Khalifatul Masih Sani, Raja Ta'ala Anhu, he very clearly explained earlier on that it's not from the family of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, that there is a constitution that, you know, whenever the election is going to take place, it's going to be the Khulafa are going to be from the family. It's in one of the Majlis Ashura, this thing was mentioned as well, that it was mentioned in the Majlis Ashura that actually they presented a suggestion that it was given by Hazrat Khalifa Masih Sani, Raza Ta'ala Anhu, that no Khalifa can appoint his son,
yes,
or his father or his close relative as the next Khalifa. So this was one of the constitution in the Majlis Shura that was mentioned there. Mm. So
and I'd also like to add something, that we cannot ignore the fact that the promised Messiah alayhi salam, who was a prophet of God, a very beloved man to Allah the Almighty, his prayers which he has done for his children, they needed to be accepted, yes, as well. And he has done so many prayers for the righteousness of his children. If you read his poetic verses, he has said that, "Oh Allah, let me see the righteousness of my children before my eyes before I pass away." And this is exactly the standard which has been set by the Holy Quran as well, that "Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum," that those people who are most righteous, they are the most honorable amongst you. So if the most righteous are those, they happen to be people from the children of the promised Messiah, then is it not just that Allah should appoint Khulafa from His children? That is the standard which Allah the Almighty has mentioned in the Holy Quran. Not biological relationship, but righteousness and virtue.
Examples of such we find in the history of religion as well. If we take the example of Hazrat Ibrahim, alayhi salatu wasalam, we find that how much he prayed for his progeny as well. Yes. And then we see the result of that, that so many prophets were then many people attained the status of prophet that were from his family or from his generation.
Yes.
So this is the example.
Well, does that answer your question? Okay, so in the third row, yes please, you're in the red.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
My question is, how can we convince Catholics about the superiority of Khilafat over the popes and popehood.
Okay, right.
Considering the similarities in, their belief that they're divinely guided as well.
Okay, brilliant. Just to explain the question again, we're answering the argument from Catholicism that the papal system, in fact, is also a divinely guided system of guidance. Therefore, if the Ahmadis, or actually in fact the Muslims, are saying, well, actually we have a Khilafat which is also divinely guided, then how do we answer that the Khilafat of the Muslims is superior to the papal system of the Catholics? That's your question, right? Thanos Yusuf.
Yes, Jazakallah. The papal system is in a way different from the Khilafat of Islam. It is said that the popes, they can never make a mistake. And in fact, it is a belief that the Catholics have that they can never make a mistake at all. So we find that in the period of history, how many mistakes did they make? And in Khilafat-e-Rashida, or in the Khilafat, you can see that divine guidance is there. But we never claim that the Khalifa is, he knows the unseen. He is there, he is divinely guided by Allah Ta'ala, but he doesn't make mistakes on any principle values. So there is a difference between Khilafat and the papal system.
Okay, yes, please.
There's
please.
Another thing as well. Let's analyze both of these systems of leadership. You have the Pope and then you have the Khulafa.
Yes.
If you look at the practical example and the practical outcome of this system, that is of the popes, I would humbly ask, what solution are they providing to the world problems that we are going through today? Are they solving conflict between people? Are they creating such unity that conflict is being driven away? I humbly beg to differ with anybody who says that they are doing a better job than the Khulafa Ahmadiyya, because the manner in which the Khulafa, they are helping to solve the problems of the world, no other leader is doing that in the same manner. And if we see in all of the sermons of Hazuri Anwar, he's always presenting a manner in which people can spiritually reform themselves. He is giving solutions to people of the world on how they can remove their conflict. And how is he doing that? He's doing that with a book which no other religion has, with the Holy Quran. Because the solutions which are provided by the Holy Quran are distinct, and the Catholic popes could not benefit from, they do not have that ability, because they don't have that wonderful teaching of Islam to help guide the people of the world who are faced with problems.
Definitely.
And conflict.
The promised Messiah والسلام, has stated that the Holy Prophet والسلام, was Khatam al-Nabiyyin, and we believing him as Khatam al-Nabiyyin, he encompassed all the qualities of all the prophets, and we as Muslims believe in not just the Holy Prophet والسلام, but we believe in all the prophets before him.
Yes.
So therefore, the Khilafat, the Ahmadiyya Khilafat, what it represents is, although it's Khilafat Allah Min Haji Nabu'at, but that Nabu'at that on the precepts of that prophethood it is, encompasses all the prophets. Whereas the Pope, I think, is very confined just to Catholicism.
Yes, definitely.
So there the difference there also highlights the...
It's a step forward, isn't it? I mean, we have the papal system, which as Shahzad Sahib and the rest of the panelists have actually explained, the papal system is a very Catholic-based system, where it believes in Jesus. Khatm al-Nabuwwat, as it were, Khatm al-Nabiyyin, our Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was a universal prophet that taught to believe in all of the prophets, and hence a khilafat from that is in fact above that which teaches only about the belief of one prophet, because we also incorporate the Christian belief. The khilafat in fact incorporates the papal system inside it, but then adds on to it as well. Does that answer your question? Okay, brilliant. Yes, please. Can we have some more questions? Yes, please, in the second row.
The Khilafat, the way it operates, a lot of people would say it's similar to dictatorship.
Okay.
Now, with the way the society is at the moment, where you see dictators are falling, and where, you know, for example, the US or the big powers, they do not allow dictatorship.
Yes.
How will the Khilafat, how will that expand? What are the indications?
Okay, brilliant. So the question basically here, the question is basically here, is that basically in a world today when we see so many democracies, I mean, if we're looking at these Western European countries, we're looking at, well, it's not Western Europe, you mentioned America as well, but we're talking about democracies. Now, another word for dictatorship is autocracy, right? So in an autocracy, in a dictatorship, we're talking about one person leading everyone else. A democracy is when the public is speaking. Ayasa, please.
Well, let's analyze what a dictatorship is. In a dictatorship, the leader or the dictator, he comes into power by hook or by crook. The people do not want him to be in leadership, but he comes by force into leadership. But if you look at Khulafa, they are elected by a body of men. And the will of the Jama'at is present in their election. However, nobody should misunderstand this to say perhaps that it is only a body of men which elect the Khalifa and not the will of God. The Holy Quran is very categorical in its statement that it is Allah the Almighty who appoints a Khalifa. But as is the system of Allah the Almighty, He administers His work through material means. So too is the case with Khilafat. He uses a body of men to elect a person who He deems fit for that post, firstly and foremost. Then another thing which we can't ignore or neglect is that the entire community stands behind that Khalifa with their heart and soul, with such utter love that that love can be found nowhere else. And this is why all of the mu'mineen, the believers, they do bath, they present their oath of allegiance before their beloved master, and they say that we are ready to stand behind you in any order that you may give us. And this is why that Khalifa is not a dictator, but somebody who has something much beyond that, and that is a relationship of love. And there is another thing as well. In a dictatorship, the dictator does not ask the opinion of anybody. He does whatever he feels is right. However, in the system of Khilafat, the Holy Prophet ﷺ has clearly mentioned this, and Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu has also alluded to this fact. He says that there can be no Khilafat without consultation. Yes. So as far as our Khulafa are concerned, they do consult their representatives or believers at a different level and get their suggestions. However, the manner in which that consultation is different than a democracy, for example, is that the Khalifa is not bound by the vote of the majority to make that decision. This is why Allah the Almighty states in the Holy Quran with regards to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that وَإِذَا عَدَمْتَ فَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ, that when you, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, decide on something, then trust in Allah that He will do the right thing. And this is the beauty of Khilafat, my dear brother, that Khilafat has something which no other leadership can have. They have divine guidance. So sometimes the Khalifa knows something which the majority may not know. That's why that door has been left open for the Khalifa to make a decision which goes against the majority. But many a times we see in the Majlis-e-Shura that the opinion of the majority is accepted by the Khalifa, but not always. So a Khalifa is different than a dictatorship.
Okay, but does that answer your question?
Yes.
Well, Jazakallah, Yasub. Okay, so can we come back to the audience, please? I want to know those questions which you're thinking about. We're carrying on this discussion and we're talking about many different things. But what this program is actually meant to do is that when the questions that come into your minds, they come here and we can discuss them. So that when those questions actually come around, as we said in the beginning of the program, the eventual aim of this program is so that we all come and we understand again. We all know what we believe in and we know why we believe in it. But these programs are here to rejuvenate that inside ourselves so that we remember why we're doing this, why we are here. When somebody comes up and stands before us, we're not the same as them. They know what they believe in, whether it's right or wrong. They know what they believe in. They know the reasons why they believe in it. But there needs to be a differentiation between us and them. We need to have that confidence to stand up and say, this is what I believe in and this is the reason why. If you don't like it, then challenge me. But when you challenge me, you will lose because we have the proofs. When we have the light behind us, then we've nothing to be fearful of. So yes, please, any questions? Yes, please.
As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. My question is that to what extent is the institution of Khilafat able to explain the truth of Dajjal?
Of the Dajjal?
Of the Dajjal.
Okay, so in terms of Khilafat, but also in terms of the teachings of the Promised Messiah salatu wasalam, and because the Prophet ﷺ was in complete accordance with the Holy Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, the question that you're basically asking is the Islamic view on the Dajjal.
Well, the explanation that Khilafat has given, we've yes. got through the Khilafat.
Adonis Yusuf.
Jazakallah. It's, you know, Khilafat does not, explain something from itself. Whatever the Khilafat takes is from the Promised Messiah ﷺ and from the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who has taken everything from the Holy Quran. So what definition or what explanation the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam gave, that's exactly what the Khulafa have been explaining to people in different manners. So whatever they have taken is from the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam. So there is nothing different that the Khulafa have mentioned.
Yes, sir, please. Could you explain slightly on this?
Well, the concept that the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, has presented with regards to the Dajjal is different than the common day scholars. The scholars believe that the Dajjal would be a man of one eye, and his other eye would be blind, and he would have a huge donkey, and that donkey would extend as if in land and sea, and it's a very comical understanding of a very wonderful prophecy of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the promised Messiah alayhi salam, as Hakam and Adal, as the person who was to come in this day and age and issue verdicts with regards to the correct understanding of the Holy Quran, he mentioned that we cannot attribute a physical understanding to the Dajjal because it would become a jest of religion. And the promised Messiah alayhi salam has mentioned that Dajjal is an Arabic word which means the great deceiver, great deception. And what is inferred by this is that those powers, those influences which were to become a deception as far as theology is concerned, that the Dajjal is a representation of that false influence, that bad influence with regards to religion and theology. And the Messiah and the Mahdi who was to come in the latter days, he was going to come to fight the evil forces, the evil spiritual forces of that deception, that theological and religious deception which was to be administered by the Dajjal. So this is, of course, is a very long topic, but just in a brief nutshell, this is the concept of Dajjal which has been presented by the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam.
And just a point to add on this is that This has actually been discussed in great detail in a past Beacon program. So if, for the benefit of viewers at home, and again for the people that are sitting here, if you wish to see any of these previous programs and look at any of the answers that our panelist members have given, you can go on to www.youtube.com/MTAonline1. And there you can view all of the various answers, and this Dajjal question was one that's been answered in very great detail. Okay, so can we have another question, please? Yes, sir, please, at the back.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
With regard to Khilafat, could you explain the electoral process of Khilafat, and in particular, could you highlight the similarities between Khilafat-e-Ahmadiyya and Khilafat-e-Rashida, and also if there were any differences in the election of the Khalifas?
Okay, so the question you're basically asking is the comparison between the Khilafat-e-Rashida and Khilafat-e-Ahmadiyya, basically, and the way in which they've been elected. So, Ayasa, following on from this question, if you'd like to answer this, but then also, how, in fact, we claim to be the Khilafat Allah Minhaj Nabuwa. Now, what's to say there's not, if another community stands up and they say, well, okay, we have a Khilafat, they elect a Khalifa, let's say. They elect a Khalifa and they say, this our Khilafat is Khilafat Allah Minhaj Nabuwa. Now, a man, the average Joe that will come along, you'll see two people, two completely different communities, both claiming that we are Khilafat Allah Minhaj Nabuwa. Join us, we are the rightly guided people, we are the rightly guided Khilafat that was prophesied in the Holy Quran. How can we differentiate between the two? What is Khilafat Allah Minhaj Nabuwa?
Well, anybody can claim that I am a Khalifa. A group of people can get together and claim that we have elected a Khalifa. But the fact of the matter is that a true Khalifa is he who Allah the Almighty calls a true Khalifa. And how do we discern that? The Holy Quran has mentioned very clearly in Surah An-Nur, there is a verse which is known as Ayat-e-Istikhlaf, which relates to the establishment of Khilafat. And in that verse, this very beautiful verse, Allah the Almighty has detailed and alluded to the characteristics of a true Khilafat. And if we understand those characteristics, we will see that those same characteristics apply to the Khulafa Rashideen. And those very same characteristics can be seen in the Khilafat-e-Ahmadiyya as well, which is a continuation in actuality of the Khulafa al-Rashidin. So what does Allah the Almighty state in Ayat Istighlaf? Allah says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ كَمَا اسْتَخْلَفَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ. That Allah the Almighty has promised to the believers those people who believe and do good works, that he would surely, most definitely makes of them successors in the earth, as he made successors in the past. So right from the outset, in the initial portion of this verse, Allah the Almighty has hit this point home, that it is I who elect a Khalifa. And nobody else has the power to elect a Khalifa unless my will is present there. Because Allah the Almighty has attributed the verb of selecting a Khalifa to himself, not to a committee of men, not to a committee of scholars, not to a group of people, or to an individual for that matter who stands up and says that I am a Khalifa now. Then after that, Allah the Almighty says that وَلَا يُمَكِّنَنَّ لَهُمْ دِينَهُمُ الَّذِي ارْتَضَى لَهُمْ, that he would establish for them their religion which he has selected for them. What does it mean to establish religion or Islam? Was Islam not already established when the Khulafa came? Of course it was, because the religion of Islam was established by the Prophet himself, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What is meant by the establishment of religion is two things. There is an internal aspect and an external aspect. The external aspect of this is that the Khulafa, the true Khulafa, their primary objective and their primary task and all of their efforts which are exerted are for one purpose, and that is for the establishment and for the propagation of the religion of Islam. And if we see the Khulafa, they gave up their sleep at night, they gave away all of their comforts for one purpose, to prove the superiority of Islam to the world and to propagate this beautiful message of Islam to the four corners of the earth. That's what the Khulafa Rashideen did, and that is what the Khulafa Ahmadiyya also do. And if we look at the daily activities of Huzur-e-Anwar, we can see very clearly that he is worried about nothing but one thing, and that is to propagate the message of Islam. That is the responsibility which Allah the Almighty has given to the Khalifa. Then the internal aspect which I was speaking about, that relates to the reformation of the believers who believe in that Khalifa. Because the Khulafa have, as well as propagating Islam, one of their prime duties is to reform the people who follow them, to spiritually enlighten them, enhance them, bring them closer to Allah the Almighty. And this in essence is the purpose of prophets as well, to reform people, to make them better people, to bring them towards Allah the Almighty. So we see that establishment of faith in the hearts of the believers. That is where the faith is established through Khilafat-e-Ahmadiyya. Then we have another aspect as well, that وَلَا يُبَدِّلَنَّهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ خَوْفِهِمْ أَمْنًا, that through Khilafat, Allah the Almighty exchanges a period of fear to security and peace. Now what is inferred by this? The fact of the matter is that without a leader, without a divinely appointed leader, the believers are in a state of disunity. And we see this practically in the Muslim Ummah. They, and I say this with great pain, we feel great sympathy for our brothers who are in a very difficult state right now. They are in disunity, as Mansoor Sahib mentioned at the beginning. They cannot even decide who is going to lead the prayers. So how can we expect that they would accomplish great feats as far as the propagation of Islam is concerned when they cannot even decide on a common issue of who will lead the prayers? And this is why Khilafat is important, because he creates unity and he changes that fear into security. And this is why, and then Hazrat Muslim radiallahu anhu has also mentioned another very interesting point. He says that not only does Khilafat change the fear of believers into security, but he, Allah, also instills peace and security into the heart of the Khalifa himself, that he does not fear anybody. He will stand up and deliver a sermon which may go against all of the political parties of the world, but he doesn't care about them, because he knows that his neck is before Allah the Almighty and he shall be answerable to him. And we see that the courage and the valiant behavior and the valiant attitude of our Khulafa with regards to spreading the truth and speaking the truth in the face of all opposition is very remarkable. Then Allah the Almighty says that يَعْبُدُونَنِي لَا يُشْرِكُونَ بِي شَيْئًا, that through Khilafat, unity is established and the believers, they will not associate any partners with me. So this unity and belief in unity of Allah can only be developed through Khilafat. And then we have another aspect, that وَمَنْ كَفَرَ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ, that since it is Allah the Almighty who has appointed that Khalifa, a person who does not believe in that Khalifa, who does not follow that Khalifa, he shall be among the rebellious. Because this is why the Holy Prophet ﷺ has mentioned that al-imamu junnatun, that a leader is like a shield, and you must stand behind that shield for protection. And if you try and walk in front of that shield, then you will come into harm's way. And then in the next verse, Allah the Almighty says that they would observe prayer and they would give the zakat and they would obey the messenger, which shows that through the establishment of Khilafat, which is a divinely appointed system of leadership, the system of zakat can be also functioning as well. Mm. And without that, because zakat collection cannot take place unless we have an administrative body and an honest administrative body.
Definitely.
And the only way we can develop an administrative body which is honest is through a person which is appointed by Allah the Almighty himself.
Definitely. Does that answer your question? Okay, brilliant. Can we have, we're coming near to the end of the program, so can we have the last couple of questions? Yes, please. Jazakallah. Yes, please.
And assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
My question is, how do you come closer to Khilafat?
Okay, well, this is a very fundamental question. We're talking about the blessings and the need of a Khilafat in this day and age. But a very fundamental question, which obviously comes in many of our young minds, is how on earth do we come close to Khilafat? Atta'una Sisa.
Jazakallah, Mansoor. The most basic and simple answer is that praying for them and asking them to pray for you. That's the way we can develop a closer relationship with Khilafat. The way we develop this relationship is by listening to the khutubat of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih. Not just listening, by obeying each and every instruction that he gives. So practically showing that we care about Khilafat. We have the respect for Khilafat. We love Khilafat. So once a person shows from the bottom of his heart that he loves Khilafat by practically obeying each and every command that comes out of the mouth of the Khalifatul Masih, Ayyadahullah Ta'ala bin Nasir al-Aziz, that's when a person develops a relationship with Khalifatul Masih. And definitely it is through the prayers of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih that we are going to have that relationship as well.
And it's important to remember here that when somebody says that I love Khilafat, now saying that I love Khilafat is all good and well, but what does this love inculcate? Love for something means when that beloved person has said something, it's like an elixir for you. It's something that gives you life. It's like a car with petrol. That when this person has said something, that's it, that's final. You live for that person's words, you live for that person's message. The only way that we can express our true love is when we obey completely, as Adana Siyusab quite rightly said, when we completely agree, or if we do not agree, regardless. When our beloved Imam, when our beloved Khalifatul Masih al-Khamis, when he has said something, when he has told us to do something, then we take that as a decision and we bring it to our hearts. In fact, this obedience topic is something which, inshallah, we'll be talking about in the next program as well. The fact that we've talked about the need and the importance of Khilafat, but in fact, we're going to look at specifically about the obedience that Khilafat requires from us. When we sell ourselves in the bayt, because bayt literally means the selling. So when we have sold ourselves for Khilafat, then what does that selling inculcate? It inculcates obedience. And this is inshallah something that we'll be looking at in the next program. Okay, so that's all we have time for today, inshallah. We will meet again in the next program. I'd like to say jazakallah to the Bradford Jama'at and the khudam that have come here today. The panel of esteemed guests, Atanasi Sahib, Ayaz Sahib and Shahzad Sahib, for providing very, very good answers for today. And most of all, I'd like to thank my dearest viewers at home. Thank you for joining us, jazakumullah. Until next time, fi amanillah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Allahumma labbaik, Allahumma labbaik, Allahumma labbaik.